Animation, a line drawing of Pike's Peak falls into place behind a line drawing of the CSDB administration building. Text around the mountains and building reads, Celebrating 150 years, 1874 to 2024, CSDB. Text below, 1901 to 1920. An ASL interpreter in the corner of the screen throughout the video. Photo, a large group of students and staff pose in a park.
At the dawn of the 20th century, Colorado Springs was a growing city. But the land east of the school was still an open prairie.
Photo, a barbed wire fence and prairie.
This made it an ideal location for a mysterious scientist to conduct his experiments.
A photo of Tesla and two newspaper articles about his arrival and lab.
Nikola Tesla, known as the Master of Electricity, arrived in 1899. By June, he had a lab on a hilltop a few blocks from the school, near what is now Kiowa Street and Foote Avenue, where he said he was researching wireless telegraphy.
Photo, interior of Tesla's lab with electricity flowing between cylinders. Photo, exterior of Tesla's lab with buildings in the distance.
A photo shows CSDB in the background.
Photo, a large hotel.
When he wasn't working, Tesla stayed at the Alta Vista Hotel downtown.
Animation, Tesla rides a horse-drawn cart with the driver.
People who saw him there recall how every day he would ride a horse-drawn wagon to his lab. Afraid of horses, he was always ready to jump out if needed.
Animation, Tesla walks outside of his station.
Every night, around midnight, he would walk back to town. Imagine how often he passed so close to the school.
Colorado Index article.
In 1901, the Colorado Index noted, "We feel quite proud that the cosmic radio signals he receives from Mars come to a point so close to the school."
Gazette article.
By 1904, his lab was abandoned.
Photos, land east of town and dairy buildings.
In 1903, a little bit further east, the school's dairy formed near what is now Pike's Peak and Iowa Avenue.
A photo of cows and a paragraph from a board report.
It provided plenty of fresh and delicious milk to the campus. According to a board report, 2/3 of the students who had been drinking coffee switched to milk. Though the dairy was 3/4 of a mile away, students would visit and report what they saw in the Colorado Index.
Colorado Index article. Photos, a graduating class and students in a wood shop.
During this time, students went to classes for 5 hours in the morning and worked in their trades for 2 hours every afternoon.
Photos of students by the barn, students painting, cows, and students weaving.
New trades included gardening, painting, dairying, and rug weaving.
Photo, 6 young students.
All students studied standard school subjects.
Montage, 3 photos of students in class.
Students who were deaf had either manual or oral classes, and students who were blind used the New York Point System, a tactile reading and writing system created in the 1860s. Although Braille was invented in 1824, it wasn't used here yet.
Photo, a large group poses outside of the main building, news articles and photos of Lottie Sullivan.
As evidence that CSDB was at the forefront in education, in 1904, 17-year-old Lottie Sullivan, the first student who was deafblind, and her teacher, Bessie Vettitz, participated in the St. Louis World's Fair.
Photos, the World's Fair Education Building and Mrs. Vettitz teaching Lottie and a boy.
For over 2 months, they demonstrated teaching methods for deafblind students in the education building and won gold medals.
Photo, a wide street at the exposition full of people with elaborate buildings on either side.
During their stay at the exposition, they visited the exhibits, and Lottie even met Helen Keller, something she had always wanted to do.
Individual photos, Lottie Sullivan and Helen Keller. Newspaper article, Lottie's essay.
She wrote an essay that appeared in the Colorado Springs Gazette, which says the machines were her favorite part.
Photo, machines at the exposition.
Innovations demonstrated for the first time included an x-ray machine.
Magazine cover, Scientific American.
Electric typewriter, and coffee maker.
Panoramic photo, CSDB campus. Newspaper article, General Palmer gives property to school for deaf and blind.
By this time, the campus was getting crowded yet again. In 1903, General Palmer donated 12 more acres of land, which extended the property east to Hancock Avenue. In 1906, the oldest remaining building, the administration building, was built.
Photo, the administration building followed by photos of each addition to the school.
Other familiar places built during this time include the barn, Jones Hall, and Palmer Hall. The industrial building was remodeled into a dorm named Humphrey Hall, and a new industrial building was added onto the boiler house. A greenhouse and a cottage used for teaching domestic science were built. A small lake named Lake McDonald was created. And a pipe organ was also added to the assembly hall.
early football photo in Colorado Index article.
As early as 1899, CSDB had its first football team.
Photos, boys baseball and basketball.
Soon, there was baseball and basketball.
Photo, 1914 football team practicing, a Colorado Index article titled The Game in the Morning slides in.
The earliest mention of a bulldog occurred in a 1914 Colorado Index article about a Thanksgiving football game between two school teams. The first team was nicknamed the Bulldogs, and the second team was called the Kittens.
Montage, photos of chicken coops, students holding chickens in Colorado Index articles.
In 1912, another extracurricular activity began. The Experimental Poultry Stations Association allowed all interested students to learn to raise chickens and sell their eggs. They kept track of the number of eggs laid and learned basic accounting by writing out bills, keeping receipts, and logging expenses and profits. Each station, or coop, was cared for by competing teams of two or more students. Later, there were also smaller stations managed by one student. They reported on their results in the Colorado Index, and students kept the profits.
Archival film, World War I soldiers marching, looking through binoculars, disembarking a ship.
While progress at the school remained steady, the world plunged into uncertainty in 1914 when World War I began in Europe. By early 1917, the United States had entered the war.
Photos of students and staff breaking ground for a garden and holding up knitted items.
The school planted a victory garden, and students sewed items for the Red Cross and sold Liberty Bonds.
A news article about Liberty Bonds.
Soon, four staff members enlisted, including Harry Black,
Colorado Index articles,
a librarian, coach, and teacher, and boys supervisor and coach Will Harbert.
Photos of Mr. Black and Mr. Harbert.
Will was the grandson of Jonathan and Mary Kennedy, and the son of printing teacher Hugh Harbert. Students attended a send-off parade for local soldiers and recall seeing Will there. In the fall of 1918, Mr. Black was deployed to France.
Archival film, World War I troops riding in a large truck, copy of a letter printed in the Colorado Index.
He wrote to his friend Alfred Brown, a teacher at the school, and described the sights and sounds of war. All the staff members survived the war, but only Will returned to CSDB.
Photo, Will Harbert. Archival film, World War I, newspaper article, peace is here at last.
On November 11, 1918, the armistice, a formal agreement to stop fighting, was signed.
Colorado Index article.
That day, at 1:40 a.m., a teenage Elsie Hodgkins woke her classmate, Dorothy Clark, to tell her there were whistles blowing in town.
Animation, three girls watch fireworks from a window and jump for joy.
They ran to a bedroom where other girls were watching fireworks from the window. They jumped for joy, knowing the war was over.
Dorothy's article, photos of soldiers in front of CSDB and carrying flags.
The next day, Dorothy describes a parade passing by. We saw hundreds of soldiers marching and automobiles decorated with flags. We saw some kiddies beating on frying pans instead of drums. When we saw the men carrying flags, we saluted and clapped our hands. Then they had their own parade on campus.
Animation, students marching, some with instruments. Article, list of do's and don'ts for combating the Spanish flu.
By remaining at the school for the parade, Superintendent Argo hoped to protect everyone from the Spanish flu pandemic, which began in 1918.
Panoramic photo, CSDB campus.
However, around Thanksgiving, the flu spread throughout the school.
Colorado Index and board report segments about the Spanish flu on campus.
Sadly, the board president, two staff members, and five students died.
Fade to black.
While students and staff were sick, there were no classes, and teachers pitched in as caregivers.
Colorado Index articles about teachers nursing students, Christmas break, and holiday celebrations.
Normally, many students would have gone home for Christmas, but that year, most stayed through the holidays. To spread a little cheer and show how much they cared, Christmas parties were held, and the superintendent, Mrs. Argo, and the staff organized a Christmas Eve celebration, which included a Christmas tree, a movie, and a visit from Santa Claus. Gifts from parents and community members were handed out. And on Christmas Day, they had a turkey dinner with mince pie and ice cream for dessert.
Photos, the 1919 football team, panorama of three campus buildings, the graduating class of 1925.
By 1919, everything was looking up. The world was on the mend. The worst of the flu pandemic had passed. And the roaring 1920s were about to kick off.